Welcome to Engineering Python. This is a Python programming course for engineers. In this video, I will talk about functions. As the program size increases, it can get more and more difficult to understand and maintain it. We can use functions to break large programs into smaller pieces. Each accomplishes a simpler task. This can make it easier to understand, maintain, and reuse a part of the program. There are generally three different types of functions. The first type includes Python built-in functions. Examples are the print function, the range function, the input function, the absolute value function, the data type conversion functions such as integer, float, string, list, tuple, dictionary, and set. You can find a complete list of Python built-in functions by clicking this link. The second type includes the function from the standard libraries. For example, there are many functions in the math library. We have seen the square root function, the ceiling function, the floor function, and the trigonometric functions such as sine and cosine. The third type includes user-defined functions, which will be the main focus of this video. User-defined functions must be defined before use. This is a function definition syntax. DEF is a Python keyword for function definition. It's followed by the function name, then a pair of parentheses. Inside the parentheses are some parameters, p1, p2, etc. There are also code formal parameters sometimes. At the end of this line is a colon. A common mistake is forgetting to include this colon mark. Immediately below this line, we have an optional documentation string enclosed by a pair of triple quotation marks. The doc string must be indented with 4 spaces to indicate it's a part of the function body. Next comes the actual statement block. It's also indented with 4 spaces. After a function is defined, we can call it using this syntax. This is the function name, followed by the arguments a1, a2, etc. They are also called actual parameters sometimes. Note that there is no colon at the end of the function call. The argument will be unpacked and assigned by position to the parameters when the function is called. Let's see an example. This function is calSum. It takes 3 parameters, x, y, and z. There is a colon at the end of this line. The doc string is indented and enclosed with triple quotation marks. It describes what this function does to calculate the sum of all the parameters. The statement block just contains one statement. It prints the sum of x, y, and z. After the function definition is finished, we call this function using the name calSum with 3 arguments. 10, 20, and 30. These 3 numbers will be assigned to x, y, and z respectively. The output is the sum 60. The doc string immediately follows the function definition. It works like a comment and can provide information about what the function does. We can use a help function to access a function's doc string. For example, help calSum will return the function's information like what parameters it has and this doc string. Note that this is just the function's name and it's not a function call, so we should not put a pair of parentheses here. Parameters may have default values. This can save the user some typing when it's called. In this example, the function has 3 parameters. 2 of them have default values. Y has a default value 100, and Z has a default value 200. So when we call this function and just supply one argument, this number 10 will be assigned to X. The other 2 parameters Y and Z will use the default values. The sum is 310. If we supply 2 arguments, then 10 will be assigned to X, and 20 will be assigned to Y. The last parameter Z will use a default value. The sum is 230. If we supply all these three arguments, then neither y nor z will use the default value. The sum is 60. The default parameters must be put after the non-default parameters. That means they must be put at the end of the parameter list. This function definition will produce a syntax error because the parameter x has a default value and it is put before the parameter y that doesn't have a default value. Python allows you to pass a variable number of arguments to a function. In this function definition, the parameters are x, y, and star var. It means this function will need at least two arguments, x and y, when it's called. The sum is given to s. If more arguments are supplied, we will use a for loop to go through every argument in var and give it to s. This function prints out s at the end. Let's call it using two arguments, 10 and 20, in this example. The sum is just 10 plus 20, which is 30. Next, we call it using 5 arguments, from 10 to 50. The result is 150, which is the sum of all these numbers. Now let's see a longer example. This program is a temperature converter. It converts the temperature from degrees Celsius to degrees Fahrenheit. The program has 4 functions. The first one is the input temperature function. It has no parameters. It prompts the user to input the temperature in degrees C, converts the input to a float number, and give it to a variable named temp, and finally return this temp back to the caller. The second function is the convert temperature function. It has one parameter C, which represents the temperature in degrees C. It uses this formula to convert the temperature to degrees F and returns the result. The third is this output temperature function. It has one parameter F, which represents the temperature in degrees F. It just prints the Fahrenheit temperature. The last one is the main function. It calls an input temperature function, gets the Celsius degrees from the user, and give it to C. Next, it calls a convert temperature function, converts C to the Fahrenheit degrees, and give it to F. Then it calls the output temperature function to show the result. Let me explain a little bit more about the last main function. Python is an interpreted language and does not require a defined main entry point in the program like C or Java. It simply executes the code line by line. However, many programmers still use the main function in their programs. It is more of a convention than a rule. It can be changed to other names. After we are done with the function definitions, let's call the main function. Enter the temperature in degrees C. I'll use 100 degrees C, which is the boiling point of water. Here is the output. The temperature is 212 degrees F. We can also test a specific function instead of calling the main function to run the entire program. This is useful when we try to debug a specific function and see if it's working properly. Let's test the convert temperature function using an argument of 100 degrees C. The output is 212 degrees F. It's working correctly. Now let's save this code in a Python file named c2f.py. .py is the extension for Python files. A Python file can also be called a Python script, a Python module, or a Python program. Open this file in the Jupyter notebook. We see the 4 function definitions. But what is the deal with the last 2 lines? Python files can be run directly. They can also work as libraries, being imported and used by other programs. When the file is run as a standalone program, we want every line in the file to be executed. By contrast, when a file is imported, we don't want to execute the program. We just want to make all the functions defined in the file available to other programs. This special variable underscore underscore name underscore underscore is used for this purpose. It determines whether a module is imported or run directly. By the way, underscore underscore is pronounced dunder. This is short for double underscores. If the file is run directly, dunder name represents a constant string, dunder main. If the file is imported, dunder name will not be dunder main anymore. It represents the file's name instead. Let's try this. Run this file in Jupyter Notebook directly using this magic percent %run and the name of the Python file. The program starts to run, enter 100 degrees C. The output is 212 degrees F. Now let's import the file into Jupyter Notebook using import the file's name without .py. After we have done this, the program didn't run. We only make all the defined functions in this file available. Later I can use these functions in this way. This statement calls the main function defined in the C2F module. This statement calls the convert temperature function defined in the C2F module. In Python programming, it is very important to understand the difference between global and local variables. Global variables are those defined outside of any function definitions. In this example, we first define a function named test. It has a local variable a, which is a string. It prints out a and then c. Note that c is not a local variable or a parameter passed into this function. It is a global variable defined outside of the function and before we call the function test. This program works with no problem. If a local variable with the same name is defined inside the function, then it will print the local variable only and not the global variable. Try this program. The C is a local variable, and we have another C that is a global variable. When we do the printing in this function, it will only print this local variable C. A variable can't be both local and global inside a function. The following program will throw out an error. Although we have a local variable C in this function, it is defined after we print C. Because the function is executed line by line, at this line, we still don't see this local variable. So this C is the global variable. Later we define this local variable C. This violates the rule I just mentioned. A variable can't be both local and global inside the same function. To fix this, we can differentiate the global C using the keyword global. In this example, before we print the variable C, we use global C to indicate it's a global variable. Later, we define a local variable C. After this, all the following references to C will be the local variable. A local variable is only valid within the function. It can't be accessed outside of the function. It disappears after the function call has finished. The following code will produce an error because we try to print variable D, which is a local variable defined in the function. The error says name D is not defined. Actually, D already disappeared after this test call is finished. The return statement is optional in the function definition. If there is a return statement, the value of the expression immediately following return will be sent back to the caller. All the statements below the return statement in the function will be ignored. For example, when we call this function, it will return the sum of x, y, and z. This return sum will be given to r. The print function will be ignored because it is put below the return statement. A common mistake when defining function is forgetting to return the result. In this example, we did calculate the sum and assign it to r, which is a local variable, but we forgot to return the value of r back to the caller. As a result, this local variable r will disappear after this function call, and this r will be a non-value. if there is no return statement or just the keyword return, but nothing follows, the function sends back a special object called none. We just saw this in the previous example. Let's see another example. In this function, we just have a return keyword, but nothing follows. So R's value is still a none. None is a special data type in Python. It's called the none type. Okay, that was a brief introduction to functions. The course materials are available on YouTube and GitHub. You can watch the course videos in sequence. If you like this video, please subscribe and share. I'm Yong Wang. Thanks for watching.